So you're CI Games, a Polish developer that's been around under a couple of different names since 2002. Now you started off existence rather humbly, as a publisher developer of mostly budget and knockoff titles. You know, the type of games that you'd see in a big bin with an everyday low price fixed above it. You plugged away at this for a while, and people must have been buying your games. After all, you didn't go out of business. Hell, you even became a publicly traded company on the Warsaw Stock Exchange in 2007. You're kind of like EA, all publicly traded and everything. Hell, maybe you want to be the Polish EA. I don't know. I'm not you. But then in 2010, something really great happens for you. You have a bona fide hit, Sniper Ghost Warrior, which sells 3 million copies the world over. So, with all that loot coming in, you start doing some growing and expanding. Now you think you got what it takes to run with the big dogs. You're gonna leave the world of budget games behind and become a AAA developer. So what do? To show the world that you've arrived? Why make a generic broken World War II first person shooter? Because you tried. Ladies and gentlemen and everybody in between, welcome to They Tried, the show where I take a look into the not-so-great in PC gaming and try to figure out what caused the game to not be so great. Now, I didn't work on this game, nor any of the games I covered, and I can and perhaps even will be wrong about some of the stuff I say here. While I'm not intentionally trying to mislead you or misrepresent facts, I am human and I have biases like everyone, so what I'm trying to say is, folks, take everything I say with a grain of salt, because I could be wrong. So with that said, for this show I have CI Games 2014 release, Enemy Front. It's an FPS that was supposed to mark the triumphant return of the AAA World War II shooter. Made with a CryEngine, Enemy Front tried to sell itself as, well, let's let the game's PR speak for itself. The first truly modern World War II FPS, featuring stunning visuals, open-ended levels, and a richly interactive combat experience that breaks out of the standard module of highly linear, scripted FPS experiences, giving the player the full freedom to own their playstyle. Intense combat, sniping, stealth, and sabotage all are viable approaches for the player, maximizing player engagement and replayability. Yeah, right. They may have been exaggerating some there, because now it's been fairly well documented that this World War II FPS isn't all that great. Right now, it's sitting at a 52 on Metacritic and a 48.25% on game rankings. And not exactly a good sign. Nor was the fact that I was able to pick up Enemy Front in a bundle for $5 with 9 other games, and also I got its DLC thrown in. Yeah, Enemy Front had DLC. After all, CI Games wants to be an honest AAA developer, and that's what they do. They all have DLC for their games. Nevertheless, at the time I bought it, it wasn't even a year since it had been released. Kinda surprising to see such a new release going for only 50 cents with its DLC. Yeah. That may not be the best sign for the CI balance sheet. Although, to be fair, CI has even admitted that Enemy Front was a commercial failure, so there's no secret in saying that this game was a commercial and critical failure. So, with that said, let's take a look at what my 50 cents bought me. Alright, so I started up a new game and selected the difficulty of medium because I'm a medium kind of guy. And then I was treated to a really nice looking loading screen. And I'm not trying to be cute here, folks. Normally I wouldn't even mention a loading screen, but this loading screen, folks, is really cool. Hell, for a while, I honestly thought it was an intro cinematic. Now, I don't know what to call this pseudo 3D visual effect, but it's easily the highlight of the game. And the fact that the loading screens, yes, there are more and they all look really cool, are the highlight of Enemy Front should be a bit indicative and enough foreshadowing about the quality of this game. Anyway, once the game was all done loading, I found myself treated to some really compressed video. It's odd and won't be as noticeable on YouTube, but for whatever reason, the intro cinematic is really compressed and full of artifacts. It's kind of jarring to see this after enjoying the slick loading screen. Yeah, I really need to stop talking about the loading screen. Back to the compressed video. I can only assume CI wanted to save space on the game file size, but really? In 2014, is that a concern anymore? What's saving a gig or two among friends? Now, maybe I did miss something in the settings, but yeah, I didn't see any options that would improve the video quality or adjust it in any way, so we just gotta live with this. And yeah, this intro is also the introduction to our hero. The dude I'll play as, the guy who's talking, the dude with the name of... I don't remember. Honestly, I'm not even sure if they say his name more than a couple of times in this entire game. And frankly, it doesn't matter if I know his name or not. After all, he's a hero in an FPS that's not a Duke Nukem game, so he's not allowed to have any personality. Nevertheless, I do know what this guy's job is. He's an American reporter reporting out of Nazi-occupied Europe. And history nerds, he's not attached to any American troops or anything like that. No, he's a regular Peter Parker behind enemy lines reporting in Nazi Europe at the height of Nazi power and is regularly able to get out news from the occupied lands. Yeah, that's a feat to say the least. Now, an interesting game could have been made about a journalist trying to report the Nazi occupation. Hell, I would really want to know just how he was able to get his reports back to America without Nazi interference or being accused of being a spy. Or just generally why he isn't one of the most wanted men by the Nazis. Because our hero is not your average journalist. He does more than reports the news. He makes it. Yeah. He kills Nazis. Yeah, for real, our war correspondent is violating the Geneva Conventions and going all Rambo. And enemy front plays all this straight, folks. Yeah, I can only shake my head in disbelief as I watched our Rambo raids on the heavy water plant in Norway, a prison camp liberation, and fighting in the Warsaw Uprising. I don't understand why the game just didn't make him the member of the SAS, an Army Ranger, or, you know, some guy with combat experience. Or better yet, why not just have multiple main characters? Because it's not like I'm particularly attached to this guy. Now, I know I've rambled on about the plot for a while, and honestly, there's not much of a plot, but it really bugs me. Basically, this newsman is Ramboing all over Europe and jumping out of planes. I could never buy into the premise of Enemy Front. It's just so dumb, and the story is just really not anything beyond newsman kills Nazis in places that you wonder how the hell he got there. But hey, maybe I could have bought into the gameplay, right? Because FPSs, they're not exactly known for their stories. Well, okay then. About that gameplay, folks. You're only allowed to carry 3 weapons and a handful of grenades because, folks, it's a modern shooter. Those days of dozens of weapons available to you all at the same time are seemingly lost. But then again, in Enemy Front, there's not much of a point to have all those slots, since there's really only 4 weapons to use: machine gun, rifle, pistol, and shotgun. Naturally, there are a few different skins and types of each of these 4, but basically, all the machine guns feel the same. All that really matters is how much ammo it holds. The pistols are completely useless under every circumstance. The rifle is only worth a damn if it has a scope, and the shotgun's only useful at point-blank range. Oh yeah, and those grenades and stuff, they do what you expect. There's just not much variety, nor really anything that unexpected with all these weapons here. They handle like you would expect, except when, well, they don't. One point comes to mind when I had some cool slow-mo shootout, and the pistol just didn't seem to hit the guy. Maybe it was meant to recreate the inner accuracy of weapons, or maybe it was just a glitch. Which neatly gets me to the heart of the matter with Enemy Front. This game is quite broken, folks, particularly when it comes to the AI and level design. The enemies seem to lose the will to live and will stand in front of you, unwilling to fire. Perhaps they've realized the error of their ways and now wish to die at the hands of our newsman. And when it does work, they're still painfully dumb. Grenades fall beside them, they don't run, and when they do run, it makes no sense. Overall, it takes away from the enjoyment of this game. It felt more like I was taking these poor souls out of their misery than fighting for my life. Oh, and you do get some of those lovely AI companions on some missions, but thankfully, they can't die. But yeah, they're useless and unable to kill anything. Or unwilling, maybe. To say the least, though, Enemy Front has some of the weakest AI I've seen in a while. And I also saw all those levels, which are a real mixed bag, if I'm going to be polite. Honestly, for a game that claims to break out of the standard module of highly linear scripted FPS experiences. Enemy Front sure seems like a highly linear FPS, just without any of the cool scripted events. Really, Enemy Front really could have used some Medal of Honor style spectacles and set pieces, because these missions are quite dull and generic. Fighting in Warsaw more often than not seemed like that old game Beachhead 2000. You stand behind a barricade and just mow down wave after wave after wave of Nazis. You don't even need to worry about conserving your ammo since you have unlimited ammo boxes lying around, which also makes it kind of hard to buy into the notion that the Poles are running out of supplies when they have all these magical ammo boxes everywhere, or even that they're losing when you're just steamrolling Nazis constantly. And yeah, it does seem like you're fighting a clone Nazi army. There's really no enemy variety here other than the officer. So basically you're killing the same dude with different guns over and over and over again until they stop coming. Hell, even the ending is lackluster. So, spoiler alert here, the game ends with our hero getting on a boat and leaving Warsaw. It's a happy ending for those of you that don't know much about history. But yeah, game just ends there, fade to black. And all this for me, all of this general lacklusterness, no real spectacle, just kind of an ending that ends, seems like a sign of quick and dirty leveling game design. What goes on in Warsaw, that wave after wave of killing Nazis, seems like a way to keep levels small and full of action without having to do too much. It's kind of a chore after a while to play this game, and I hadn't even started to talk about the rest of the game or its missions. But yeah, they're really not all that remarkable or interesting. The non-Warsaw bits tend to follow the same formula, a kind of openish area that then moves to a closed, narrow corridor shooter. It's all a fairly linear game. Basically, how it works is you play Cell in Warsaw, then you have a flashback of him and say Norway, and then, well, the game ends after 6 hours or so. Sure, it tries to shake up some of its linear gameplay by allowing you to attack the Nazis head-on or take a detour around them in places. It kind of reminds me, though, of those light gun games that let you choose left or right in parts. Because no matter what you do, you're going to end up in the same place and killing the same guys. It's just whether you want to see their face or the side of them. Moreover, the levels just seem unfinished, unpolished, and, well, Frankenstein together. There's really no flow to them. And with no enemy or mission variety short of opening a door for some dudes, it's just really more of the same with Enemy Front. Kill the same dudes, do the same thing, which is kill more of the same dudes. Yeah, it all sounds very unremarkable and uninteresting, doesn't it? Well, let's talk about the more interesting parts of this game, and that's all the bugs and glitches and things that are just fat out broken, folks. Yes, I'm walking through these locked doors. Yes, this guy's just spinning around. And yes, this Nazi and myself, we just can't seem to be able to kill one another. On every level, you'll find about 2 or 3 weird glitches or broken bits. And overall, even when everything's fine, I just can't help but shake this notion that this game is dull and generic. Short of killing Nazis with the same guns, there's just not much else to do except marvel at the bugs. Granted, there are a few environmental kills you can try, but it takes the patience of a saint to get them to work. As does the stealth in this game. Oh my god, I almost forgot about the stealth in this game because that's a selling point. Hell, the only way I honestly knew that this game had a stealth system was because I was given silencers on some guns and I was able to throw rocks to distract the Nazis. But with AI as bad as this, stealth is virtually pointless. Just run and gun. Save yourself some frustration. Just kill them all when you see them. Hell, you'll avoid seeing the hero clipping through Nazis he stabs and, well, frankly, there's just no reason to try anything stealthy. Now, on some levels, I did try to make an honest try at it and artificially challenge myself to be sneaky, but the AI is just so dumb, and the levels tend to have broken bits or glitches. It's just all an exercise in futility, and it's just not fun. There's way better stealth games out there. Why play this one? But thankfully, though, there is no forced stealth sequences. Okay, maybe I'm being overtly negative here. But you see still, at best, Enemy Front's just a poor man's Medal of Honor. The broken bits are really the only compelling bits about this game, because the bits that work belong to a dull, uninspired, generic Nazi-killing shooter. Sure, it does feature some of the lesser-known locations to kill Nazis in, but this game doesn't really do much with those locations. Hell, they could have set on the moon for all I care. It still wouldn't have made this game all that much more compelling. This game has been done before a lot, and it's been done a lot better. Enemy Front just really lacks any personality, any identity, anything that really distinguishes it from any other not really good World War II shooter. It reminds me a lot of the type of shooter that CI used to make back in the City Interactive days. And with nothing new to offer, nor really anything to hook you in, there's just not much here going on. But the question still remains, folks. How did this happen? Who thought the game I just described was a good idea to release? After all, it was supposed to be the return of the almighty AAA World War II shooter. Well, folks, would you believe it? But Enemy Front had a kind of troubled production. So, ladies and gentlemen, and everybody in between, let's go back to the long-lost year of 2010, when then City Interactive decided to use some of that sniper money to establish a development studio in London, England, with Stuart Black at the helm. Now, if you don't know who Stuart Black is, well, he's been in the industry for a while. He got his start at Argonaut Games and worked alongside Peter Montague at Bullfrog. And after Bullfrog was bought up by EA, he bummed around until he ended up at Criterion Games, where he would create the game that would be his claim to fame. That game being the first-person shooter called Black. Hell, I think it was even named after him. Anyway, Black was one of the first heavily stylized cinematic shooters, aka the modern military shooter. It seems to have done alright, and it's now developed something of a cult following. Hell, some even hail it as a classic. Nevertheless, Mr. Black left Criterion and then bummed around the industry again until he started work for City Interactive. After he joined on, City announced that Mr. Black would be working on a new IP, a World War II first-person shooter called Enemy Front. I should point out that it seems that the idea of Enemy Front was kicking around City before Mr. Black joined. Nevertheless, early on, it sounded like Enemy Front was going to be something a lot different than what I just reviewed. In early previews, Mr. Black was keen to point out that Enemy Front would be something different than the typical World War II shooter fare. He said, quote, "We hopefully want to modernize it and take like a modern blockbuster kind of approach to it. And get out of that Saving Private Ryan runt. We want you to be the hero. We want you to go back to the old 70s movies. That kind of man on a mission flavor. Dirty Dozen in particular. Where the Eagles Dare. That was a big influence. So that kind of became our template. Getting back to the more action-oriented thing instead of that reverential approach to the war. Keep it authentic. Authentic weapons. Authentic locations. But get a bit more adventurous spirit into the action. Particularly the story." Now damn, that game does sound a lot more compelling than the game that Enemy Front ended up becoming. And the more old previews I dug up, the more and more I kept hearing about how Enemy Front was going to move away from what World War II games had become. I got the sense that this game was going to try to break the mold and have lots of personality, which, other than some locations and a dozen different enemy types with unique abilities, that seemed to be really the core difference between this Enemy Front and the one that released. Because again, based off of all the previews, a lot of the core design elements don't seem all that different from what was released. It was going to be a fairly linear game, allowing for stealthy or run-and-gun gameplay, and production must have been humming along. Hell, CI even seems to have had a working demo that they were showing to the press, and a release date. It was slated for 2012 on everything known to man other than the Wii U, and then, rather suddenly, Mr. Black was laid off. It appears that Mr. Black's vision for the game wasn't what CI Games had in mind. City Interactive CEO Mark Tominski stated that Mr. Black was let go after they found out his vision for Enemy Front was different from their expectations. Following the first game shows, press releases, we decided, taking into account the media attention, and now we have made a number of quite significant changes to the game, storyline and assumptions including the main character. We are currently working on these elements along with others. A very experienced person in the industry in the United States, Mark Bristol, recently we decided to create an extensive multiplayer mode, which our team in Romania is responsible for. So, from what I understand, it appears that CI Games fired Mr. Black because they didn't like the game's direction. But Mr. Black did have some quotes on the matter. I don't really have an answer for why. Nobody ever really talked to me about any of the problems, either with how I work or the quality of work that was being done. It was all kind of the opposite. Everyone was really happy with the work. One thing that I can think of is that when I was off doing my thing in the States, telling people there's going to be a Dirty Dozen where the Eagles Dare kind of vibe to the game rather than the Saving Private Ryan reverential vibe, and actually they were going, no, we want Saving Private Ryan. So I think it's safe to say that the break between Mr. Black and CI Games was the direction that Enemy Front was headed in, namely that irreverent tone, which, to be honest with you, it's kind of surprising that there would be a problem between the two. After all, Enemy Front was being previewed, and that was a big selling point, it seemed. Or at least the one that Mr. Black wanted to emphasize. Even early on, they kept talking about how this game was going to be irreverent and different than the norm in the World War II shooter world. So, the bosses at CI couldn't have been blind to this. They had to have known the direction that the game was going in. After all, this was to be a AAA game, and those type of games cost some real money to make. I'm talking hundreds of thousands to millions of dollars. So they had to have known what was going on with Enemy Front. They had to have been scrutinizing it and approving it. Also bear in mind, the game was in development for 2 years before Mr. Black was fired, so I just don't quite understand why there was a sudden break. And, well, this is where we enter the realm of speculation and my personal opinion, because I think something else was at play here. That being the power that focus groups, marketers, and PR people have over big AAA games. Honestly, with big games, it becomes less about the game and really more about how to sell it, because frankly, a lot of money's at stake. Now, I don't know how City works or worked, so again, this is my personal view, but I can see how CI saw this change was necessary, that they needed to get away from that irreverent tone and make a more formulaic shooter, because, well, when you see what CI changed in the game after Mr. Black left, there's some telltale signs here. For starters, earlier on, Mr. Black emphasized how he didn't want to have a real multiplayer aspect to this game. Hell, in old interviews, he even said that making an extensive multiplayer would be fruitless in a world with Battlefield and Medal of Honor, which is reasonable and perfectly understandable. Supporting a multiplayer can get expensive, especially if no one's playing it. However, City suddenly wanted an extensive multiplayer, and I think this is because that's what other AAA shooters have, regardless if it makes any sense. AAA needs multiplayer because that's what all the other AAA games have. And I did try to test out the multiplayer aspects of Enemy Front, but, well, no one was playing it, so it looks like Mr. Black was right. So you can tell that there's been a change in design philosophy. Moreover, because of the change, the irreverent tone had to go, because again, AAA shooters are serious things where you press X to pay respects. Irreverence has no place. Military shooters are supposed to be mature and cinematic. Basically, it seems like the marketers and the PR people got control of this game, and basically the type of game that these people want to make are knockoffs. Likely they looked at the old Medal of Honor games or the Battlefield titles and thought, hey, guys, you ought to make that because that's what people like to play, or at least that's what people played. Again, I could be speaking out of turn, but that's my thoughts on the matter. To me anyway, it seems like the marketers got control of this game. And even the things they were saying, the exaggerations, make no sense if you play games. Like calling Enemy Front an open world game is absurd. Calling it a non-linear shooter is, again, kind of a lie. And saying that it's doing anything unique or interesting is, again, a lie. It feels like a poor man's Medal of Honor ripoff because that's likely what the marketing people wanted CI to make. So let's plot the changes with Enemy Front after Mr. Black left. It seems like Mark Bristol was brought in as the new creative director, and he's a man to blame for the change in the main character and for the story in general, because he takes credit for it. Maybe the original hero was too interesting. Another name attached to the game was Stephen Skelton, who was a creative director and producer, and he seems to have helped lead development of the game. And then, CI also hired Raphael van Lierpop, this guy, to helm the game's redesign. So CI wasn't completely scrapping this game, but it was completely redesigning it. So that may very well explain the kind of Frankenstein puzzled together nature that the game's levels and design seems to have, because it was redesigned. And this guy only worked on the game for 6 months, and he was asked to completely overhaul the creative direction for this CryEngine 3-powered World War II FPS and deliver a AAA vertical slice in 6 months. In that time, I took the game from a tired linear experience to an open-world sandbox shooter. Yeah, you did. With a proper narrative and high-quality production values, and then handed it back to the studio leadership to complete. Sorry, I cracked up a few times there because, you know, If the earlier version was a tired linear experience, and the release version of Enemy Front was an open world sandbox shooter with proper narrative and high production quality values, then I don't know what any of those words mean anymore, folks. But that's all resume hype. This guy has since moved on to better things. He founded Hinterland Studio and is now working on The Long Dark. To trace what happened, Mr. Black's been fired. They redesigned the game, basically cannibalizing it to make it a kind of generic open world, high quality, proper, narratively driven shooter. And then things get a bit messy. They brought in some other guys to, well, redesign the AI and start changing the games to make it shippable to AAA quality. And all these guys that came on, they seemed like they were there for like 6 months, 9 months. Basically, it's easy to take the piss out of these guys' work, but it's really unfair because based on these rolling credits of people joining the development of Enemy Front, I'm just starting to get the picture that CI Games wanted to completely overhaul this game in a really short amount of time. And they also wanted it to be a sandbox AAA shooter, but they wanted it in less than a year. Now, I could only sympathize with these guys working at Enemy Front, because a lot was really asked for them in a short period of time. And it seems like most of the guys working on Enemy Front were let go after the game was published. With that knowledge in mind, I think it's easy to see how this game turned out to be not so good. It was basically a rush job, a cannibalization of a previous title that was hurried out as quickly as possible. It's no surprise that there's bugs and there's glitches and it's broken and the game's flow seems kind of jilted, because CI Games wanted this game done yesterday. And it's also easy to see why they would too, because this game was slated for the PS3, Xbox 360, and you know, the old console generation. So there was a probably hard timeline to get this game done. Corners had to be cut, ideas dropped, concepts just altogether thrown out, because this game had to ship at a certain date. And there's that old saying that goes, you can want something done right, or you can want something done quickly, but you can't have both. And Enemy Front is a product of something just done quickly. It all makes sense to me now. I can see it. I can see the strain. I can see the wear and tear on this game's design. I can see the long hours being poured in just to make it function. And I can also see that they just didn't have enough time to really quality control this game. That probably explains why all the bugs were in there. They were just happy that they got something that didn't crash when you installed it. And odds are, at this point, maybe CI was just writing off Enemy Front. They released it for $30, a kind of budget price, and likely all they cared about is getting the game to work well enough that maybe they could recoup some of the money they threw at it. But, well, it didn't work out that way. And that right there, folks, is probably a lesson for any of you in development land. It's hard to make good work. It's hard to make AAA quality work when you're being rushed. And that's what Enemy Front is. It's a rushed out game that's generic because there's no room for creativity when you're trying to rush through your work. It's broken because nobody had time to fix all the broken bits. And it's just uninspired because, well, I don't know if this was anyone's baby. It seems to have been Mr. Black's baby, but after that, it just seems almost like there's a conveyor belt industrial development nature to this game just to get it out on time so it can hit the last gen systems. And that's my thought. That's why I think this game turned out bad. And maybe I'm wrong. Or maybe I'm right. Or maybe you don't care and you just found this video to be interesting. So on that note, ladies and gentlemen, and everybody in between, I've been some guy. This has been They Tried, a look into the not so great in PC gaming. And I'll see you guys next time when I don't know what I'll do next time, honestly. I have a few ideas out there. Maybe ride to hell. Maybe, folks. Alright, I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.